We are going to continue today the topic we have started yesterday. So if you remember, we were in I am still in the first chapter of the course, and I was in the section, the third section of this chapter, which was about why people were so obsessed by constructions with ruler and compass. Okay, so let me rewrite this little title now. So why, let me say it short, ruler and compass. So this was more or less the title of the section I gave yesterday. I was just telling you yesterday, when it was time to stop, that one of the reasons was a previous crisis which happened in Greek mathematics in ancient days. But I did not have time enough to explain you what this crisis was about. So it's time now to do so. So this crisis in mathematics happened during more or less Pythagorean time. I mean, it was in Pythagorean school, so something I would say around 500 before Christ. So in Pythagorean school. So, what was this crisis about? So, in order to understand that, you have to understand what was mathematics for these people at that time. What could it mean to practice math for these people? So, at that time, mathematics were not considered as a tool to make computations. This was not the main goal, computations for money or whatever. They wanted to do something else. And the goal was very higher than simply computation. And the goal was a kind of philosophy. We could say that almost a religion, I would say, but it was at least a philosophy. And this philosophy was the philosophy of universal harmony. So these people believe to a principle which says that the total universe, I mean the planet Earth, the stars, the sky, everything, was governed by a principle of universal harmony. And mathematics was nothing for the people but the manifestation of this universal harmony by numbers. So mathematics, so this was the point of view of the people of this school. Mathematics was nothing but a manifestation of this harmony, by numbers . And when I say by numbers, I also mean, because the words were more or less the same, by pictures. Pictures and numbers were living together. So, and pictures. So when I say pictures, I mean the mathematical figures. The classical one, triangles, circles, square, rectangles, and so on. So, we have to understand that, to understand why there should be a crisis in math at that time. So, mathematics and numbers should be a manifestation of this harmony, and this manifestation were not the only one. Another one was music. So, music was another manifestation. Of harmony. So when I say music, so it means that people here in this school didn't mean music for dance, you know, Saturday evening we go and dance. No, this was not the point. The point that the harmony was supposed to be achieved by a sound at the same time with another sound would produce something extremely beautiful, more than beautiful, harmonious, right? So this was the classical philosophy at that time. You have to know that about Pythagoras, it's himself. We know about his life and his writing, more or less nothing. Not more or less nothing. We have nothing sure about him. So the dates, for example, are not precise at all. What we know, we think to know about Pythagoras has been written by Greek historians several centuries after Pythagoras, 200, 300 years after Pythagoras. So the quality of this testimony, of course, is a bit doubtful. But still, this school survived to Pythagoras, and somehow Plato, we discussed Plato yesterday, was a kind of a long time after pupil of Pythagoras. Okay. So what could cause a crisis in math from this point of view? So from this point of view, the only numbers given by nature are, as you can guess, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. So the positive integers. So this was considered as the single numbers possible. Moreover, if you work with integer numbers, you are necessarily interested in relation or proportions between them. So when I say proportion between two integer numbers, I mean a fraction. A fraction means, as you know, a rational number. So at the same time, of course, and as well, the proportions between these numbers . So when I say a proportion between two integer, of course I mean a fraction, p over q, where p is a integer and q is a integer, not zero. So what we call now, of course, a rational number. So according to this point of view, the point of view of these people, every geometric picture should be described by means of rational numbers. So every length, every area of a natural geometric object should be a rational number. That's this point of view. What happened to them is the discovery of irrational numbers. I never know if we need 2n or 1. So I'm going to change from time to time, it would be 1n, because suggestion? 1 is enough, perfect for me. So irrational, thank you. Discovery of irrational numbers in elementary pictures. Once again, what we know about that is a kind of a legend. It's not an historic fact that one day, Monday morning, a guy came to this school and say to the other, why people listen to me, I guess I have an irrational number. No, nobody knows exactly what happened. There is a legend which says that the poor guy in this school who made this discovery has been killed by the other ones. They do not want him to say this bad news to the world. So this news was considered as so bad that in the legend, this guy has been killed. So I will take some precaution here with you. I don't know how you behave. And so the philosophy of that is don't mess with mathematicians, of course. So the problem we are going to try to deal with now is how this discovery could have been made by these guys at that time. We discussed this yesterday. They mostly work with geometry. So the question is there a natural geometric way to be convinced of the existence of irrational numbers? And this is what we are going to study now. So in this, so I will end this section here, and we start the next section in the same chapter one, and this will be the final section of this chapter, about the various proofs of the existence of irrational numbers. So proofs with an S, we will see a few of them, of existence of irrational number. And what I have in mind here is mostly the famous number square root of 2. So which is obviously, I don't know if it is that obvious, but you probably know that this number is not rational. And we are going to discuss this fact from several very different points of view, as you will see. So first proof, so 4a, the geometric proof. Let me say, à la grecque. By à la grecque, I mean as the Greek guys of this time could have done. So let me be honest here, nobody knows exactly how they what they did to prove the irrationality of square root of 2. So what we are going to study now is a possible way, possible geometric way, to be convinced of the irrationality of square root of 2. So at that time, they work with pictures. So let me draw a picture on the board. The picture is the following one. You consider these two edges, both of them of length 1. And you know, of course, and they know that this hypotenuse here has length square root of 2. So this is the most basic picture which could appear in geometry, besides circles, of course. So obviously, at the time of Pythagoras, they drew a lot of this picture, of course. So from this picture, we are going to prove that square root of 2 cannot be a rational number. So we proceed, as you can guess, by assuming that square root of 2 is rational, and we go to a contradiction. So assume that square root of 2 is equal to p over q, which is a fraction, which is a rational number. Okay? So the construction is the following. If you multiply the three sides of this triangle, so of course here it's a, I didn't draw it here. Of course this is a 90 degrees angle, of course. So if you multiply this picture here, the three sides of this triangle by q, what do you get? You get another triangle with the same angles here, just bigger size, but the angles are the same, okay? And here, the sides which were 1 and 1 here becomes, you multiply by q, so becomes q and q. And this size, square root of 2, becomes pi. So we multiply the three sides of this triangle by 2, by q, the denominator of this fraction here. Of course, assuming that square root of 2 is equal to this fraction. So I'm going to draw more or less the same picture, and you can have in mind that this picture is bigger than the initial one, but the shape of the triangle is the same. The two sides here are equal, and they are equal to q. Clear? And the hypotenuse of this triangle, instead of being p divided by q, becomes p. And here you have a 90 degree angle, right? So what do you get in this picture? You get what is called a rectangle isosceles triangle whose every side is an integer, p, p, and q. So let me write it here. Hence, we get an isosceles rectangle triangle with integer size. Is it clear for everybody? Of course, you get this if you have assumed at the beginning that square root of 2 was a rational number. And from this, we are going to obtain something which is impossible. How do we proceed? If such a triangle exists, there exists in particular a triangle with smallest possible size. You consider in this family of triangles satisfying this property, you consider the smallest one, that is with the smallest size. Okay? So consider among these triangles the smallest one. It exists. If there is someone of side 2 here, and another one of side 1, take the one of side 1. Okay, so you take the smallest one. Is it clear? It exists because the sides are integers. So at some point it has to stop. There is a smallest integer here. Okay, once again I draw the picture. The same picture. And let's assume that the letters we have here are precisely the smallest one. So let me write again q, q, and p. So far, so good. So now, we are going to draw something inside this triangle. You consider a circle whose center is this point, and the radius of the circle is precisely q. So let me draw a part of the circle, and it will do something like that. Do you see the picture? So the center is here, upstairs. The radius is q, and you do this. You draw a part of the circle. So here, you have q. Let me mark with a single chalk here the side of length q. Q here. Here you have q. Here is another one. I don't know which one it is so far. Well, I know that it is p minus q, this one. This length here is p minus q. You have q here again. And so far, this is what you have. OK? Très bien. So now we are pretty close to the result. Let me also draw the angles. here you have the right angle, here you have an angle, something, which could be computed, but its exact value does not interest me here. And here you have the same angle, because the triangle is isosceles, right? So, if you follow me so far, we have almost done the complete picture, and I will end this picture with the last side, which is the following one. I am going to draw the segment which starts at this point of the circle and which is orthogonal to this side, to the hypotenuse. So let me draw here this new and last side. So here we have a right angle. By definition, I draw this segment with a right angle. This segment is, how do you call that, a tangent to the circle. Okay? Now we are done. We are not just going to analyze the picture, but the picture is complete now. So how can we analyze this picture? I want to understand everything about the small triangle which is down here. So how can I do that? I'm going to check the angles. I claim, and you will tell me if you agree with that, that the angle here is the same as the angle here. Do you agree with that? Yeah. Is it obvious for everybody? I mean, yeah. The reason, what is the reason of that? Yeah. I mean, why it is isosceles?
Because when we look at the bigger triangle,
exactly,
the small angle over there is the same with the top one.
Yeah, exactly.
So the rest is also
exactly.
Since there's 90 degrees over there.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So we know already two angles, so we know the third one in a triangle. Huh? Okay. So we know that this one has to be exactly the same. This is obvious. You remember that the sum of the three angles of a triangle is pi, or 140 degrees if you think in degrees. Perfect. Now I'm going to make a claim, and I will claim this on the picture. I guess you will understand the claim by itself. Follow me. I claim this. So far, so good. This little triangle is isosceles because we have two equal angles. So this is free. But I claim also this. Is it obvious? Is it immediate that this side here, so this means from here to this vertex of the triangle. I claim that this side here is equal to this one and this one. Is it clear? Is anybody can explain this? It's not difficult, there is nothing, no dirty trick here, it just... If you are not immediately convinced by that, let me do a zoom of this part of the of this picture. Let me draw this two radius of the circle. So you have a radius here, another one here. You have here. You have the circle here. And you have this guy here with a right angle, and this guy here with also a right angle. So the two intersect here. Is the picture clear? So what you get here, you can draw the mediatrix between these two points as usual. And this mediatrix, so let me add another color here, this mediatrix is here, right? Which explained immediately. So this kind of thing was immediately obvious for these guys. They were trained to that, to detect these things in pictures. So we see in this little picture that this side here is equal to this one. No question? Clear so far? Okay. So my picture here is correct. Now there is something impossible here. Why it is impossible? What is impossible in my general picture here? What can we say about the sides of the little triangle here? This side is p minus q, integer, natural number. This one here, what it is? This one is equal to this one. Okay, this is what we just proved here. So, but what is this one? This one is, q is the total length. Huh? So this one is p minus q, p minus q, p minus q. Okay. Can you read? This is small. So this one here is how much? 2q minus p. Okay. Correct. That's it. Watch me. I can make mistake on the board. So which means that p minus q, 2q minus p, natural number. Natural number, natural number. So what do we get here? We get a rectangle, a triangle with a right angle here, isocel, with integer sides smaller than this one, which was supposed to be the smallest one. So contradiction. So the little triangle here . Are you convinced by the proof? Nothing really hard, actually. It's a beautiful one, I would say. So the little triangle has sides equal to, what did we say? P minus Q, P minus Q, and the last one, 2Q minus P, which all are integers, okay? And it is, and this triangle is rectangle, isocel, and smaller. So by smaller, I mean that its sides are smaller than the initial one, what I call the initial one is this one here, which was supposed to be the smallest one. So contradiction. Which was supposed to be the smallest one. End of this proof here. So end of this geometric proof of the irrationality of square root of 2. Is it clear for everybody? I consider this proof as very beautiful. Elementary, totally elementary, and smart at the same time. Elementary and smart and beautiful are not contradictory. So I will suggest for you an exercise now. Of course, I say that it is elementary, but if you have any question, please ask. So the exercise is try to do something similar. Similar for square root of 3 and square root of 5, which are also two classical irrational numbers associated to simple pictures. That's a good exercise. Don't be confused. When I say something similar, I don't mean that it will be the exact same picture with an isocel triangle and so on. It could be a rectangle that time. Who knows? Not necessarily part of a square. So similar means, you have, means some freedom. Okay. So the problem of the Greeks were, okay, so now it seems that irrational numbers they have to be reasonable. They had to be reasonable. When I say they, I mean the ancient Greeks here. Irrational numbers are of like square root of 2, square root of 3, and so on, are unavoidable. You cannot avoid them. Okay? They appear immediately in the most basic pictures. So you cannot drop them away if you are interested in geometry. Which means that the initial system of integers and proportions with integer is too small. They had to be reasonable and to admit this. Okay, so what they wanted to do is to enlarge this system, to consider a bigger one, a bigger system of numbers, which would include this new numbers here. And this new system, according to them, seem to be what we call now the system of constructible numbers with ruler and compass. So let me write it. These numbers are unavoidable. So the system of the system of numbers, integers, and proportions between them is too small. So let's consider a bigger one, which contains this irrational number, but not too big. I mean, the smallest one, which could be enough to do the geometry that they used to do. A bigger one, but not too big. So it's very reasonable to think that they could consider at that time that this new big system of numbers could be the system of constructible numbers with ruler and compass that we are going to define in a moment. So possibly a good candidate could be the system of constructible numbers with ruler and compass. So this is a very possible explanation for the obsession of Greek mathematics for these new numbers here. So I am aware of the fact that I didn't define this system clearly so far. I mentioned the tools yesterday, but I didn't define it properly. So it will be done very soon in this course. Okay. So don't worry, this system, which is the topic of this general course, will be defined properly at the right time. Okay, so for the moment, I will consider again square root of 2. So what have been done so far is a possible geometric proof of its irrationality. I don't know how they did exactly at the time of Pythagoras, but very possibly something like that we did today. Okay, so now I say that I wanted to show you several proofs of this irrationality to show you that we can consider the same basic problem with very different points of view and then learn things from this approach. So it's time now to consider a second approach. And probably this one is familiar to you. So the first proof was geometric. The second proof is arithmetic. Arithmetic proof of, so I will not write it each time, of irrationality of square root of 2. Now I am proving the same statement. So you probably heard of Euclides, and his many books. This is a kind of basic of encyclopedia of our modern mathematics. The proof of square root of 2, as far as I know, does not appear in Euclid, in the books of Euclid. However, all the tools necessary to give this arithmetic proof can be found in the books of Euclid. So I don't know why it is not written clearly in this book, but they have all the tools in hand. So what is the arithmetic proof? It's the following. Let me remind you something. There is something that you probably know, all of you, which is classical, which is called the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. Does it sound familiar to you? This theorem says that every natural number can be written as a product of prime, yes, you know that. So, of prime numbers raised to some powers, and in a unique way. Okay. So, I will be short here. Every n belonging to n can be written n minus 0 as p1. L1, pk, lk, of course, where p1, pk are prime numbers, and L1, lk are positive powers. Lk belong to n minus 0. Okay, so this will be the key of the second proof of the irrationality of square root of 2. Here on the board I will write only the proof for square root of 2. If you understand it, you can immediately switch to square root of 3, 5 and so on. Of course, this is exactly the same. But to be homogeneous, I will keep square root of 2 in this talk. So everybody knows that here, right? So this is what we are going to use. Once again, assume that square root of 2 is rational. Assume square root of 2 rational. So once again, we want to proceed by contradiction. That is, we want to reach a contradiction, an impossibility from this assumption here. So if it is rational, it is a fraction. So square root of 2 is a fraction. Say n divided by m. OK? Of course, here m, so n and m are integers, and m is not 0. Of course, I can simplify this equation, multiply everything by m, so I obtain m square root of 2 equals n. And then I can raise everybody to the square, power 2. So we obtain m squared times 2 equals n squared. Okay? So, what can we deduce from this?
Two divides n squared.
Exactly. This is exactly said that 2 is a divider of n squared. So 2 divides n squared. But look, if you write n in this form here, as a product of powers raised, of prime number raised to some powers, which it means that p1 and pq are the prime divisors of n. If you raise n to the square, you will obtain p1 2l1 and so on, pk 2lk, which means that n here and n square here have the same prime factors, p1, p2, pk. Okay? So it means that if 2 divides n squared, so 2 is one of these guys, p1, p2, pk. It implies that actually 2 divides n itself. So this is the basic of the classical proof in arithmetic. So what we get here is if 2 divides n squared, then 2 divides n. So let me write it. N equals 2 multiplied by n1. This is the same. So I say that n is divisible by 2. So it has a factor n1 here. And I can replace in this equation n by 2n1. So what do I get? I get m squared times 2 equals 4 n1 squared. So obviously I can simplify here by 2. So I obtain m squared equal 2 n1 squared. And I can do the trick again. That is, 2 divides m squared, so 2 divides n. Okay? So which implies that actually 2 divides m for the exact same reason. So we deduce from that I can write m equals 2 m1. Correct? So if I replace once again m squared here by 2 m1, I obtain 4 m1 squared equals 2 n1 squared. And I can divide by 2 once again, and I obtain 2 m1 squared equals n squared. n1 squared. Remember that we started from here, from this equation here. So what does it mean here? It means that we have now all the tools we need to get a contradiction. So we started from nm, which is a solution of the problem, of the equation two y squared equals x squared. So you replace here y by m and x by n. So this pair is a solution of this equation. And if we have a solution, what did we prove actually? We proved that if we have a solution, we have another solution, which is m1, n1. So we have another solution. Which is n1, m1. That's the point of the proof. If we have a solution, yes?
When we write root 2 as a fraction, you could have said n and m are relatively prime.
Yeah, no, I understand, but precisely, I don't want to say that. I could, but I prefer to say something else, and you will see what in a second. I understand your point, it is correct. Of course, we could. But I want to show something which is useful for other proofs here. And this is what's going to happen now. So what we did here is, if there is a solution, nm, there is another one, n1, n1, m1. Clear? And this one is better. Why is it better? It's better because it is smaller. N1 is smaller than n, and m1 is smaller than m. So here we have this, n1 is smaller than n, and m1 is smaller than m. Correct? But now I can do this again. I start with n1, m1, and I will produce another solution, even better, n2, m2, smaller and smaller, right? So from n1, m1, we can produce another solution, which is n2, m2, correct? The same trick works. And this solution is even better because n2 is smaller than n1 and m2 is smaller than m2. And I could spend the whole afternoon playing this, okay? And tomorrow and the day after. So what we are doing here has a name. We are producing what is called now, even in difficult topics in arithmetic, we are producing what is called an infinite Fermat descent. This process of producing solution simpler and simpler, when I say simpler, I mean smaller, smaller and smaller, and this process never stops. You know Fermat, you know probably the name of Fermat. Fermat was a famous French arithmetician. And actually, he is more famous for something he didn't prove, that were the things he proved, and which he could not prove at that time. But still, what he did in his books is pretty good, as even if the big one has not been proved. So, in particular, in several of these proofs of more complicated things in arithmetic, he used this process. That if an equation has solution, it must have a simpler solution, and so on and so on. This happened several times. He was very proud of this discovery, and he wrote to some of his friends wrote to them that this was something absolutely marvelous. So where is the contradiction here? The contradiction, I don't stop the proof. Huh? Where is the contradiction? The contradiction is we start, for example, from n, which is bigger than n1, bigger than n2, bigger than n3, and so on. This is what produced this approach. Is it possible? It's obviously not possible, because all these numbers are positive integers. You cannot have infinite sequence, decreasing sequence of positive integers. You start from 2000, at some point it has to stop. Okay, so this is impossible. We cannot have, there cannot exist an infinite decreasing sequence of positive integers. So contradiction, because we produced one. So contradiction. correct? So I like this this proof. I mean, usually the beginning of the proof, you can read it, probably you already study it in books. And actually, as you said, Eren, classically in books, we consider N and M relatively prime. So we could stop here. But I like this proof here with infinite Fermat descent because it is used in other problems. And it's very, very useful and not known enough tool here. So it could be a good, it was a good occasion for me to show this new point of view here. So this ends the proof B. So there is now a proof C. Well, there is now, maybe after a little break, yeah, time for a little break, and then proof C. Okay, so I start now the next proof of irrationality of square root of 2. So the goal of this proof, beside proving again that square root of 2 is irrational, is now to examine another point of view from math, which is called the point of view of dynamical systems, which you may heard a little bit about, which is a bit more complicated than the things we did before. And I will use here some linear algebras, that is, some matrices and vectors. So we work here in R2. So R2 is the plane, and I will consider what is called a linear transformation F from R2 to R2. So do you know or not what is a linear transformation? So you have to answer me to that. Do you know that we can associate a matrix, a square matrix, with two lines and two columns to a linear transformation? So you are familiar with that, right? So now here in R2, there is a natural basis. Basis, which is consists in the vector e1, which is 1, 0, and the vector e2 equals 0, 1. In this basis, a linear transformation has a matrix. So we consider here the linear transformation F and I will define F with its matrix in this classical, in the natural basis of R2. By the basis with its matrix, capital A, which is, so let me read my notes to avoid mistakes. So this matrix is first line, minus 1, 2, and second line, 1, minus 1. So first row, sorry. What did I say? Minus 1, 2, thank you. And second one, okay. So I am going to study this linear transformation with the help of the matrix which describe it in the classical basis of R2. So let me introduce, let me give you a definition. Definition. Consider a vector V0 in R2. Okay. What I'm going to define is what is classically called the orbit of this vector with respect to the linear transformation F. So the orbit of v0 under, so v0 is a vector I have here. The orbit on, of, sorry, of v0, excuse me, of v0 under the action of f is the set of the following vectors, so v0 itself, f of v0, f of v0, and so on. Am I clear? So f, I see f as a transformation which acts on vectors, and again, and again, and again, and again. Am I clear? So this again and again and again is exactly what I call a dynamical point of view on the action, about the action of f. So of course classical notation, because I'm not going to write f, 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 f each time. Of course the notation is the following. For every n in n, I will define, so let me write it there, I will define fn of v as f of f of f of v n times. Am I clear? And in particular, if n equals 0, f0 of v is v. So f0 is the identity transformation. So with this point of view, if you start with the classical, so let me draw a picture. Well, let me draw the classical axis, the classical orthogonal basis of R2. You start with a vector v0 here. You start with a vector v0, wherever it is, so v, sorry. This is the first vector. And now I am going only to draw the end point of the vector, not the total arrow, but only the end point. So you want to understand here f of v, f2 of v, I don't know, f3 of v, and so on. So this sequence of points here is the orbit of v under the action of f. So remark, understanding the behavior of f as a dynamical system means understanding the shape of the orbits. So first example, f given by the matrix so let me call E this matrix 2, 0, 0, 3, for example. Okay? So my question is, can we describe the orbits of any vector under the action of f? Of course, my matrix here is very simple. And this is why I give you this first example, because the computations are not going to be complicated. So let's try to do so. So what do I want to compute? I want to compute, just don't write it, I want to compute f of f for any vector v, right? So let me start with the vector v of coordinates, say a, b. So let me check if you are familiar with matrix computation. What is f of v in this case? How can I compute f of v? Exactly. So you just multiply the matrix by the vector, and here the matrix is a diagonal matrix, so the computations are obvious. So f of v can be computed by a times v, okay? You compute the matrix multiplied by the vector, and here the matrix is diagonal, so it is nothing but 2a, 3b. Clear for everybody? Now we do it again. F of v, this is what I called here f2 of v, right? And this is very easy. You multiply this one by 2 and this one by 3. So now we have 2 squared times e and 3 squared times b. You see my point? So obviously, you are able to compute for any vector v the vector fn of v by the coordinates, which are going to be 2 raised to n times a and 3 raised to n times b. Am I clear? So this is the action of f. You multiply the first coordinate by 2 each time, and the second coordinate by 3. Right? So what is the orbit of a vector here? Where the points are going under the action of this dynamical system. So you start with a general point here, a, b. Right? You can imagine the vector v here. So what is the action of f on this point? We said that. We multiply the first coordinate by 2, and the second by 3, and again, and again, and again. So we could draw the sequence of points. So I draw it very approximate here. And what's happening here? Something like that, right? So the point is literally going away. The two coordinates, x and y, goes to infinity. So that's a very easy orbit. 2n times a goes to plus infinity. Maybe not plus, to infinity, plus or minus, depending on the sign of a. If a is negative, of course, this goes to minus infinity. And the same for 3na, which goes to plus or minus infinity. Correct? Depending on the signs of a or b. No objection? Of course, there are special cases. For example, if a equals 0, and b is not zero. For example, b positive. So now it means that my first point is here. So this is the point 0b. Right? So this is my first point, say. So I want to understand the orbit of this point. Where is it going when I apply f and f and f again? But obviously, here you will obtain the sequence of points. 2n times a means 0, and here 3 to the n times b, which means that if you start with a point on the vertical axis, you will stay inside the vertical axis and go to plus infinity upstairs here. So the orbit is here. So the action as a dynamical system is pushing the point vertically. Obviously, you understand that if I started here, I would go down. You see my point? So some points are very special orbits. A point on the vertical axis has a vertical orbit, going up or going down. Obviously, it is the same if you start here. If the point starts, the initial point is this one, the orbit of this point is here. And it goes that way. And of course, you understand. Okay. So what is the effect of this dynamical system? This dynamical system is a bomb. You throw the bomb in the middle of the plane, everything blows up. And every point goes away. But some points goes away in a very special way, precisely. They go horizontally or vertically. Is it clear? So all this is a consequence of the fact that my matrix here is very special. It is a diagonal matrix, and everybody in this room can do the computations like that. So let me give you another simple example, but with a different behavior, a bit more involved. So second example here. Now consider F given by the matrix. Let me keep the 2 here, 2, 0, 0, and instead of 3 on the diagonal, I write 1/3. Why not? So it's a bit more complicated because of that, precisely. 1/3, instead of being bigger than 1, is smaller than 1. So something is going to change, obviously. But the computations are obvious. So we can compute the orbit of V. If V is equal to the point A, B, Fn of V is 2 to the n times A and 1/3 to the n times B. Same computation. You just multiply by the coefficient of the matrix n times. So what is now the behavior of the orbits? So let me start by the special points. Once again, the special points are on the axis, horizontal axis, or on the vertical axis. So if my vector v here, I say vector or point, whatever. If I start here, so let me ask you the question, what is the orbit of this point? Where is it going under the action of F? Yeah, I guess I agree with your jest. She did something like, and I agree. Of course, because A is positive here, B is zero, so here the second coordinate is going to stay zero, to be, but here 2 to the n times A goes to plus infinity. So the orbit is here, that way. The point is pushed away by the dynamical system. Of course, in the same spirit, if you start here, I guess everybody understands that the system acts, blows, but in the opposite direction. Correct? Now, if you start, let me change the color for that, with the point which is on the positive ordinate axis, what is the orbit of this point? Where does it go under the action of F?
Towards origin.
Sorry?
Towards origin.
Towards?
Origin.
Let's check. I don't know. Let's check. So here it means that A equals zero and B is positive. So when you multiply zero by two dots and it stays zero, so we stay in the same axis, vertical axis, but here 1/3 to the n, when n goes to infinity, 1/3 to the n goes to zero. Okay? Remember that. That's the difference with the previous example. 1/3 to the n goes to zero when n goes to infinity. Right? Which means that if we start with a point here, it's going down, attracted by zero. So the orbit is there. Everybody agrees with that? The coordinate of the points goes down to zero. So we say, so this is the language of dynamical system. We say that the point, every point here, is attracted by zero. You see the dynamical vocabulary here. The point goes here or there. So here, this point, if I blow on it, it goes down to zero. Of course, if I start here, everybody guess that this is going to happen same way. So zero is the origin here. Zero is a strange point. He attracts vertically, but he repels horizontally. He push away horizontally, but he attracts vertically. So it's a strange point. It is half attractor and half repulsor. Now, if I consider any point which is not on the axis, somehow the orbit of this point will follow the general behavior. Vertically, it will go down, and horizontally, it will go away. So the orbit of any points here in this quadrant is something like that. So it goes down to the axis, horizontal axis, but it goes away to infinity on the right. And now we can complete the picture. The dynamical system here acts in that direction, and here in that direction. And I forgot something. Here, sorry. Everybody agrees? Okay, so this is exactly what we call the description of a dynamical system. So you can describe, if I give you any point in the plane, you can tell what's going to happen to this point in the future, right? Do you understand the point, this point of view? So this, typically, this point of view is instead of considering a simple matrix multiplied by a vector, and then you stop, you act with the matrix again and again and again. So you transform the system and you want to understand how the space after some time is transformed by the action of this system, right? Okay, so now example one here and example two here were obvious. But now I come back to my friend here, this matrix R. And now good luck, okay? Good luck. So we come back to A, so which is my one, my minus one, two, one, minus one. More or less, I want to play the same game. I want to understand the orbits of every point under the action of this dynamical system F. If I want to do so, what is the computation to be done? If I want to compute Fn applied to every vector v, with v equal ab, what I have to do is to compute a times a times a nth time, nth times, multiplied by the vector v. You agree with that? This is exactly what we did here. But for a diagonal matrix, a times a times a times a is very easy. You just raise the diagonal numbers here to the power n. But if the matrix is not diagonal, this is a much more difficult exercise in general. So the problem is the following. Problem. In order to understand the behavior of the orbits for every point, the orbits of every point. We would have to compute A raised to the nth power. We should compute A times A times A nth time, which is equal to A to the n. Here is nth times. Okay, that's the problem. Okay, so let's try to be modest here. And let me ask you this question here. A square. So there is something I like to do. This is the way I teach this kind of things to my students. When you have to compute the products of two matrices, so you write the matrix, minus one, and you write it again, but you write it up, minus one, one, two, and one. And then the result appears here. So for example, this coefficient here is minus one times minus one, which is one, plus two, which is three. So far, so good. Here, minus one times two is minus two again, minus four, fantastic. Here, three plus two is three plus two. No, plus one, minus one, plus minus one, which is minus two. Let's do it again. Minus one, I'm lost with this matrix here. So let's do this again. Minus one is minus two, and the last one, I don't even check. I trust two forever now. Okay. So we could do it twice, three times, four times, and at some point it could be boring, I guess, the computation. Why? Because we could do that, but we could not detect a general shape of the result, which could lead us to the general form we want to have, which is A to the n. So what can we do? So we're going to cheat a little bit, because actually I know the result. I know the result, I know what can be done, and I will give you something that probably you have not learned yet. Which makes this computation very simple. To understand that, remember the simple example we had here. In these two examples, we had special points. Here, this point, which is on the horizontal axis, is very special because it goes to infinity and the orbit stays on the same line. And this is the same here. So if we start with a point here, the computation is extremely easy. The same situation here. If the point is here, the orbit is complicated. But if the point is here, the orbit is extremely simple, right? Which means that for some vectors, the computations, apparently, in this situation, seems to be very simple. So the hope we can have is that for this matrix here, there exist special vectors for which the computation will be easy. So does there exist? The question is, does there exist special vectors? And the answer is yes. There is a general way to find these vectors, but I am not going to teach you this general way because it's outside of the topic of this course. I am just going to give you the result, to tell you what are these special vectors here. So the first one is, let me call it V1. And it is minus square root of 2 and 1. Let me check simply the result, not to give you a false information and write mistake. Sorry, it's square root of 2, no minus. You can erase the minus here, it was my mistake, sorry for that. So I claim that this vector here is special. What I do mean by that, I mean that the product A times V1 has something special. So we are going to finish quietly this course by doing this computation and trying to understand why this vector is so special, and so that we can compute easily the orbit of this vector here. So computation of this guy here. So the matrix is minus 1, 2, and 1, minus 1. I multiply by my vector V1 here. Right? So what is the result? The result is, so minus 1, so minus square root of 2 plus 2. And second coordinate is square root of 2 minus 1. I claim that there is something special in this result. And could you detect what is special here? There is something very particular, which is might be not obvious to see at the first glance.
First.
Yeah. Sorry, louder, please. I'm sorry.
First one is multiplied by root 2.
Yeah, I agree. Something like that. Yes, exactly. So
it's like
yeah.
A to A.
It's like, sorry.
Root 2A.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I agree. So here, when you start from this coordinate, the second one, which is 1, so to obtain this one, you multiply by square root of 2 minus 1, right? What's happening here? How do we go from square root of 2 to this one? Well, let me check, and let me factor square root of 2 here. So this is square root of 2. Multiply by, so watch my computation, I can do mistakes, minus 1 plus square root of 2, right? And here is square root of 2 minus 1, correct? So you recognize here on the two rows, square root of 2 minus 1, here and there. Which means that actually here, this computation gives you that A multiplied by V1 is nothing but square root of 2 minus 1 multiplied by V1. Correct? So this is what you were saying. So this is special. This is what I call special. I multiply the vector by a matrix, and what I get is a vector which is parallel to V1, collinear to V1, right? And I can compute the factor of collinearity. Everybody understand the computation? Which means what? Which means that now, if I want to compute the orbit of V1, it will be easy. So what is the orbit of V1? The orbit of V1 is given by Fn of V1. What is it? Can somebody give me the answer to that? Exactly. Simply, each time you apply F to V1, you multiply by square root of 2 minus 1. Okay, so I do this nth time. What I get here is square root of 2 minus 1 to the n time V1. Okay? So let's draw a picture to see what's happening for V1 and its orbit. So I draw the classical coordinate system. Now I draw V1. What is V1? So I have to check, it's written somewhere. V1 is square root of 2 and 1. So let me draw this point, square root of 2, 1. So I need coordinates here. square root of 2 is something like 1.4, I guess, with the precision of the board. I don't need extra decimals. So square root of 2 is somewhere here, and the other coordinate is here. So I would say that V1 is here, roughly, correct?
So,
silence. I finish computation. So, agree? Square root of 2, horizontal, 1, vertical. So this is the point V1. Now, each time I multiply by F, I multiply by square root of 2 minus 1. Right? How much is it? Square root of 2 is something like 1.4. Minus 1 is something like 0.4. So I multiply by a number which is smaller than 0, than 1. Let me write this. I guess everybody agree. 0 is smaller than square root of 2 minus 1, smaller than 1. So each time I apply F, I multiply by a number which is smaller than 1. So the orbit is here. Let me draw the points. Here, 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 and here. That direction. Correct? So we obtain a sequence of points which goes to zero. Yeah? Which is attracted by zero. So let me write this in English, and we will stop on this information here. Tomorrow we'll see how it is related to. You probably forgot what we are doing today. You forgot that we are trying to prove that square root of 2 is irrational. So there is a connection between this picture and the irrationality of square root of 2. So the orbs, for the moment, what we get is the orbit of V1 is attracted by 0. You see what I mean? It's a sequence of points which has 0 as limit point. Okay? So let me add a last sentence and then I stop because you are tied. From this observation here, this orbit attracted to 0, we will prove that square root of 2 cannot be a rational number, just by this dynamical approach of the problem. And you can think to that by yourself for tomorrow.